Now, we've all done it. Yeah, even you. We've all had those conversations, and sometimes heated debates about who's the best player, which team will win in a head-to-head matchup, or who does this kid remind me of? You see, everyone has an answer. Everyone has their own specific criteria that they base their own decision on. So me, I decided to dig a little deeper. I decided to crush the numbers and look at all the facts to really show why I came up with my opinion. Now, some may agree, and a lot of you won't. But one thing that I know we have in common is our love for sports. So first and foremost, I want to say I appreciate you taking the time out to check in and see what this whole thing is about. So just sit back, relax, and enjoy the first episode of Mr. Who You With. One of the hottest debates in the sports universe will always be which team would win between two teams from different eras. Today we're going to highlight two of the greatest college football teams in history, Tommie Frazier and the 1995 Nebraska Corn Huskers versus Ed Reed and the loaded 2001 Miami Hurricanes. Let's see what we come up with. The 95 Corn Huskers came into the season on cloud nine. They were defending national champions with two Heisman hopefuls, quarterback Tommie Frazier and troubled but talented running back Lawrence Phillips. The offensive line was known as the pipeline because year in and year out, they produced All-American after All-American. Let me throw a few numbers at you. Nebraska's average margin of victory was 39 points. They scored an average of 52 points a game, and that season beat four top 10 teams. The average margin, 49-18. The whole season, they only trailed once. The rushing attack accounted for 51 touchdowns and 400 yards a game, while only allowing six touchdowns and 78 rushing yards a game. This is truly a dominant team. On the offensive side, it speaks for itself. And on defense, they were tough. They only gave up 14 points a game, and their closest margin of victory was a 14-point win against Washington State. The Nebraska offense, they set an NCAA record by averaging 7 rushing yards per attempt. They allowed 0 quarterback sacks that season and only gave up 5 punt returns the whole season for a total of 12 yards. That's crazy. Next up, the U. Miami came into the 0-1 season with a chip on their shoulder. The previous season, despite beating Florida State head-to-head and being ranked higher in both human polls, Florida State, and not Miami, was chosen by the BCS computers to play in the national championship. On top of it all, Miami would be bringing in a new head coach, Larry Coker, who would be replacing former head coach Butch Davis, who left Miami for the NFL Cleveland Browns. Despite everything, the University of Miami played the 0-1 season lights out. They even set an NCAA record for the largest margin of victory of consecutive ranked opponents, 124-7, against number 15 Syracuse and number 11 Washington. They were truly a team on a mission. So, it's easy to see both of these teams were dominant. Now, let's compare the stats and see who would come out on top in a head-to-head matchup. 95 Nebraska versus 2001 Miami. So let's start off with the quarterback position. Miami, they had Ken Dorsey, who at year's end would be a Heisman Trophy finalist, would win the NCAA Quarterback of the Year, the Chick Harley Award, the Archie Griffin Award, and the Maxwell Award. So the question with Dorsey, was he a system quarterback and just a product of all the talent he had around him? Or was he truly a special college quarterback? I mean, the offense did set a school scoring record with 512 points that season. Nebraska, on the other hand, had touchdown Tommie Frazier, who was an all-world college quarterback. In 95, he was a consensus All-American, the Johnny Unitas Golden Arm Award winner, a Heisman Trophy Award runner-up, and in 2013, he was elected into the College Football Hall of Fame. Sports Illustrated selected him to its NCAA All-Century team as major. One play describes Tommie Frazier in the Fiesta Bowl that year. On what appeared to be a routine short yardage option, Frazier kept the ball, turned up field, and after breaking seven tackles, would be on his way to a career-high 75-yard touchdown run that would later be named by Sports Illustrated as one of college football's greatest plays. Tommie Frazier was that dude. So with that, I give the edge to Nebraska. I mean, Ken Dorsey held his own and did all he needed for Miami to be successful. But Tommie Frazier, he was a talent. And without him, Nebraska may not have been Nebraska. Next up, we have the running backs. Miami, they had a stable of future NFL stars in the backfield. True freshman Frank Gore, 0-2 Heisman Trophy finalist Willis McGahee, and they were led by Clinton Portis, who led the team with over 1,300 yards and 11 rushing TDs. Nebraska, they had their own set of talented backs, led by early Heisman frontrunner Lawrence Phillips, who was fresh off of a 1,826-yard season in 94, and high school All-American Ahmad Green was coming in, who would eventually earn Big 8 All-Conference and Freshman of the Year honors. With these two units, it's hard to give an edge to either side, but me, I gotta give a slight edge to Nebraska. With the yards and performance they put up, along with setting the national record for most yards per carry, it's hard to put them on the same scale as anybody. So once again, Nebraska gets the edge at the running back position. Andre Johnson, Daryl Jones, and tight end Jeremy Shockey headlined the Miami aerial attack. Jeremy Shockey was a consensus All-American in 2001, and Andre Johnson accounted for two touchdowns and 199 yards in the Rose Bowl alone. Just for a little statistical reference, Fester Johnson led Nebraska in receiving with 22 receptions and 367 yards the entire 1995 season. Jeremy Shockey, on the other hand, had 45 catches and 604 yards in 01. Nebraska, with their high power running game, didn't really need a passing attack, and the numbers show. So with that being said, it's a huge edge for Miami when it comes to the wide receiver. Next up, we have the Hogs on the O-line. Miami, they had two All-American tackles, Joaquin Gonzalez and Brian McKinney, who was a consensus All-American pick. Guard Martin Bimler and center Brett Romberg were first-team All-Conference. At Nebraska, once again, they were the pipeline. You had a first-team All-American with Aaron Graham at center, a third-team All-American with Aaron Taylor at guard, and first-team All-Conference selections, Eric Anderson and Chris Dishman. Along with a record-setting rushing attack, the Cornhuskers' O-line didn't allow a single sack all season. This one, once again, was tough. With the talent on both sides, I gave this matchup a split. Next up, we're going to flip sides to the defense and check out the defensive line. The Hurricane defensive line was led by first-team All-Conference defensive end Jerome McDougal and future NFL first-round pick William Joseph. Big Vince Wilford was not yet a starter, but provided depth at the defensive tackle position. For Nebraska, one phrase says it all: the black shirts. The Cornhusker defense was led in 95 by the defensive front of walk-on turned first-team All-American Jared Tomich, future NFL number 6 overall pick defensive end Grant Wistrom, and the Peter brothers, Christian and Jason, along with freshman Mike Rucker, who would later go on to have an 8-year NFL career highlighted by a 2003 Pro Bowl selection in the Carolina Panthers. This one has an edge towards Nebraska. Even though Miami had some big names on the D-line, they were young. They were about a year away from being great. And like I said before, Vince Wilford was only there for depth. He wasn't even a starter yet. Nebraska gets the edge on this one. Linebacker. In his first year as starter, Jonathan Vilma established himself as the leader of the K linebacking unit. He was joined by a player who legendary coach and sportscaster John Madden once described as the only player he'd ever seen who could jump straight from high school into the NFL, DJ Williams. Nebraska was led by junior college transfer Terrell Farley, who ranked first on the team in tackles with 62, interceptions with 3, and blocked kicks with 2, along with 5 sacks that made him second on the team. Between the two units, this may be the one area where both teams had flaws. I gave the edge to Miami strictly based on the athletes they had. Jonathan Vilma and DJ Williams would go on to have great NFL careers. DBU. With a secondary that included future first round NFL draft picks Phillip Buchanan and Mike Rupp at quarterbacks, along with true freshman Antrell Roll and Sean Taylor in the mix, Ed Reed was the undisputed heart and soul of the Hurricane defense, and he closed out the 0-1 season as a consensus first team All-American and a Jim Thorpe Award finalist, as well as cementing the spot as one of the all-time great Miami Hurricanes. The Nebraska secondary featured Michael Booker, who after 4 tackles, 3 pass deflections, and an interception return for a touchdown, was named Fiesta Bowl Defensive MVP. They also had Mike Benner, who started at strong safety and would later have a 10-year career with the Carolina Panthers. The edge here goes straight to Miami. I mean, one name alone, Ed Reed, was enough. But when you factor in Phillip Buchanan, Sean Taylor, Antrell Roll, Kelly Jennings, Mike Rump, among others, yeah, this may have been one of the strongest defensive backfields ever. Edge goes to University of Miami. To round out both teams, we're going to check out the special team unit. Miami consisted of first-team All-American kicker Todd Sievers, first-team All-Conference punter Freddie Capshaw, who was also a finalist for the Ray Guy Award as the best punter in the nation, and All-American punt return specialist Phillip Buchanan. Nebraska had punter Jesse Koch, who had only 5 punt returns for a total of 12 yards the whole season in 95, and true freshman kicker Chris Brown. Nah, not that Chris Brown, who would later be drafted by the Pittsburgh Steelers in 1999. The edge here is easy. Miami had 2 All-Americans and an All-Conference punter up for the Ray Guy Award, so the U rounds it out with special teams. To conclude our eval of both teams, we got to look at the head coaches. Miami had Larry Coker, who was promoted from offensive coordinator to head coach of the Hurricanes after Butch Davis left for the Cleveland Browns in February of 01. Miami administrator's first 2 choices of Dave Wanstead and Barry Alvarez turned the job down. In addition, many Hurricane players, especially leader Ed Reed, lobbied for Coker's promotion. They believed that not changing the system would be key to win the title that evaded them in 2000. Obviously it worked, and Miami won a national championship. The following year, however, it's believed by many that a coaching error cost Miami its 2nd consecutive title. After a horrific leg injury to Willis McGahee, Coker decided not to bring in Frank Gore to replace McGahee because he didn't want to burn Gore's red shirt. Thing is, Gore still ended up leaving Miami early for the NFL, so it didn't help. Nebraska had coach Tom Osborne, who was the model of consistency. His teams never won fewer than 9 games in a season, and they finished in the top 15 of the final AP poll 24 out of 25 years, and were ranked in the top 25 for 304 out of 307 of the games he coached. Osborne teams were known for their powerful rushing attack and their strong defense. In 1999, Coach Osborne was inducted into the College Football Hall of Fame. It doesn't get too much better than Tom Osborne. Edge here, straight Nebraska. So with all that being said, who's my pick? Nebraska 95 would defeat the 0-1 Miami Hurricanes for 2 reasons. 1, ball control. 2, coaching. With with the three-headed monster of Tommie Frazier, Lawrence Phillips, and Amon Green, one thing that Nebraska can definitely do is control the line of scrimmage and in turn control the clock. Look at the high-powered Florida team. The fun and gun Spurrier team, with all the offensive power they had, could not outgun the Nebraska Corn Huskers. A lot of that goes directly to their head coach, Tom Osborne. My biggest struggle in Miami, their head coach, Larry Coker. Just look at the stats. From 2001 on, every year that Miami team failed to reach their potential. Eventually, Larry Coker was fired. Tom Osborne is a Hall of Fame coach. But my opinion only matters to me. So guys, let me know who you with. Oh yeah, and don't forget, if you like this content, please like and subscribe for your boy so you get all notifications of future videos. Who you with?